This is a Global News special presentation.
Thank you so much for joining us today. Merry Christmas. Happy
Merry
holidays
Christmas.
To you and your family. It's great to see you here.
So great to be
at
here.
This Greek establishment, institution, as you call it. As I was saying, I'm Greek, and so that dictates like everything I do at the holidays, which means eating a lot.
Lots of food.
What is Christmas like at the Trudeau house?
Food, family, usually outside adventures. If there's enough snow, sledding and building snow forts. If there's not enough snow, whatever we can do outside, it tends to be a time to gather the family together. And we all lead some busy lives. Mm-hmm. That taking a moment to really sit back, eat way too much, and and sit on the couch while we watch the kids play with presents.
And so, what do you guys eat?
It'll be a list of everything from turkey to roast beef to
all the meats
with extra meat on the side.
Right.
Yeah, usually.
And do you cook or does someone else cook?
I usually do pretty good scrambled eggs. I'll take care of the breakfast shift on special occasions, but at dinner, my mom is the classic turkey expert. So
she'll be spending the holidays with you?
Yeah, she'll come for Christmas. Yeah,
that's good. And what about gifts? Do you guys exchange gifts?
Well, we it's getting so big that we try to do a little bit of Secret Santa stuff. Every year we try and limit the amount of gifts that the kids get because there's so many extended family that they ended up getting too much. So it's you balance it a little bit. Hit of the holidays is always some little gift that nobody thought about that ends up being a really cool game, or it's not never what you predict.
Do you buy the gifts?
Are
you a little
busy?
The
only thing I still insist on buying.
Really?
I'll go and spend a few hours buying way too much Lego and cool puzzles and stuff for the kids.
when I was thinking about like what kind of questions I would ask you about your traditions, I was thinking, I think everybody, when they buy gifts for their kids, they're like, let's not get carried away. We don't want to spoil them. But for you, is it, you have this added pressure of, I don't even know if normal is the right word, but how do you sort of keep it normal for your kids? Not just at Christmas, but is that like something
that's
going through your mind?
Well, we try and minimize the things that need batteries. So
it's one method.
Lego, puzzles, board games. The kids are on a real board games kick these days, which is a lot of fun because it keeps the family all together. So we're breaking out all the old classics like Game of Life we found the other day, which was an early Christmas present that we grew up with. Little just things to keep the kids in an analog world as opposed to the digital.
Is it hard in a more general sense to keep things normal for them? Is there even such a thing as normal?
Well, see, that's sort of the thing. I mean, I grew up with
it.
And when I think back to the the exposure I had to my father's job as Prime Minister and the things that mattered, I was actually thinking about that because I really understood kind of what my dad did on that day in April in 1982 when I sat on Parliament Hill and watched him sign the Constitution with the Queen. And a few weeks ago, I almost at a last-minute thing decided to bring the kids into the house for the apology to the LGBTQ community. And it was really neat for me to be able to share that aspect of my job of taking responsibility for things in the past in what was a really emotional moment for a lot of people in that house, to highlight that this is the kind of things you need to do to build a fairer society, recognize the past, take responsibility for it, move forward in the right way. Having tangible examples of really meaningful things for them to be able to understand tends to keep it all in a little bit more in perspective.
Is there anything that you kind of went through or experienced in your sort of abnormal upbringing that you try to do differently with your kids?
No. A lot of obviously everything's different, 30, 40 years later, but the frame of making sure they have good friends, they have lots of activities, that we balance sort of normal family time, going for hikes in the woods or playing in a playground, or me taking Zav to, hockey arena too early in the morning to watch him play. These kinds of things are our real life, or it's the anchor of the real life that we lead that will be constant, regardless of whether we're in politics or not, and building those relationships and a sense of continuity that life will always involve, you know, family doing things together and being there for each other and remembering what matters beyond the particular circumstances we're in now.
Your upbringing has been the focus for critics lately, I guess, when they're talking about your upbringing and maybe Minister Morneau's wealth, when they're talking about the controversy surrounding him. And when I was thinking about the past few months, I was sort of, you know, I've interviewed him and obviously heard what you've said about the situation. And the critics seem to be on one side saying, you know, he really should have gone further. He broke the rules. This is on him. Or not broke the rules, but he followed the rules, but he should have done more. And on the other side, you guys saying, look, he followed the rules. When he heard he should do more, he did do more. Is there any kind of gray area there?
You know, this whole issue, as you just laid out, he did follow the rules. Could he have done more? Sure. As soon as it was brought to his attention, he did do more. This is something that has been really focused on by the opposition. And one of the things you sort of have to reflect on is if they're spending all their time on personal attacks and on, you know, supposed ethical issues, why aren't they talking about the economy? Why aren't they talking about job numbers? Why aren't they talking about the things that matter concretely in people's day-to-day lives? And the answer is they don't have much to criticize us on that level.
So do you think that people don't really care about it? Like, do you think it didn't really matter to people?
No, people care about it. People care about ethics. People care about values. I mean, we ran a campaign on more openness, more transparency, and we've largely delivered on that. And that's something that matters because people's confidence in their institutions, their confidence in government, really does matter. And that's why you know, the constant engagement that we have outside of the House of Commons with Canadians, whether it's in by-election campaigns or in town hall tours, which I'm going to be doing again in January, this is a really important time to pay attention to what Canadians are worried about.
Did you have any say in sort of how Minister Morneau navigated that whole thing, or was it all him?
No, I told him to, you know, tell the truth and be responsible, and that's exactly what he's continuing to do, and to stay focused on delivering on the real things that matter, which we've been able to do.
You talk about what Canadians sort of are thinking about, what they care about. We're heading into the new year. I know myself, I'm sure a lot of others are thinking about paying taxes, and I know you've also spoken a lot about this fall, you know, paying your fair share. Mm-hmm. How do you, sitting in that position, inspire people to sort of, you know, give it their all, work harder, when at the end of the day, they're forking over, you know, half their income, half of what they make to taxes, and you're telling some of them you're still not paying enough?
Well, I think people understand that we have a system, we inherited a system that allows and encourages wealthy individuals to use different methods that, you know, legitimately within the system that ordinary people don't have access to. And one of the promises we made to Canadians when we got elected in 2015 is we were going to make sure the system was fair for everyone. And it didn't strike us as fair that a large number of wealthy individuals were encouraged by our tax system. They didn't do anything wrong, but we have a tax structure that encouraged them to use private corporations as a way of paying lower tax rates than many middle-class Canadians. So we committed to make a tweak to that, and we have made a change to that to ensure that hardworking middle-class small businesses benefit from the lowering of tax rates for small businesses, but that high-net-worth individuals are no longer encouraged to use, you know, small business structures as a way of getting out of paying taxes.
But I guess, how do you sort of encourage, you know, I think if you are a small business owner, and I come from a family of them, and you weren't doing those or using those methods so you could pay less taxes, it was also to mitigate the risk that you've taken. I mean, you've got people on your payroll, that kind of thing. So how do you square the circle there? You
know? Well,
like, how do you convince someone who owns a small business it's still worth it?
Well, we are lowering taxes for 100% of small businesses. We're dropping that tax rate down to 9% over the next 2 years. So as of January 1st, they'll be paying less taxes for every single small business. Now, there are smaller issues like income sprinkling, where only 3% of the 1.8 million small businesses in this country actually use income sprinkling. And we've specified and clarified the rules so that folks that have spouses that work in the business, kids that work in the business, will continue to be able to do that. But those who are using it unfairly will no longer be able to. And I think that's what everyone understands.
Okay, we'll leave it there. We're just going to take a quick break and we'll pick up the conversation right after that. Welcome back. I want to sort of move the discussion outside of Canada for a minute to everyone's favorite subject, I'm sure yours, Donald Trump. Recently, the German foreign minister said that that the U.S. has lost its moral leadership under Donald Trump, and I think others have said that as well. What do you make of that statement?
I think it's obvious that the direction that the U.S. has taken has been a little more America first, a little more focused inwards, a little more protectionistic, a little more disengaged from some of the traditional ways that the United States has been actively leading on the world stage. And that has left a bit of an opportunity for other countries to stand up in defense of the multilateral system, to show a little more active leadership on the world stage. And certainly that's something that the Canadians, who have always been engaged on the world stage as a country, but also as individuals spread around the world, we're happy to sort of continue to step up on and perhaps be a little more noticed in this moment where the U.S. is taking a bit of a step.
And what are some specific ways that?
Well, on peacekeeping, for example, we just made a huge commitment that is transforming the way peacekeeping works. Whereas right now we have 100,000 UN peacekeepers around the world, 600 Canadians, no matter how great, and they always are exceptional, 600 troops aren't going to make a huge difference on their own within 100,000 peacekeeping troops around the world. So what we've said is the way we're going to engage those men and women with forces is going to be around shifting the pledges so that they have a larger leveraging impact on bringing more women into peacekeeping, in fighting against and being more effective in countering the impact of child soldiers and keeping kids from being soldiers in foreign combatant situations.
When will Canadians know the details of that UN peacekeeping mission?
We already have elements
of
details.
But with respect, basically all we know is that it's not going to be like the old type of mission. We don't know where those 600, in which different places they'll be or anything
like that. Well, in the old days, it would have been 600 to one place. This is not what we're going to do. And that's one of the shifts that the UN has actually asked for. What do they particularly need in different places? Well, we could use helicopters in this place. We need medical professionals in this place and medics. We actually need command structure over here so Canada can be more spread out and responsive to the needs they have instead of saying, well, we're taking over country X and we're going to keep it safe. The nature of international engagements and unstable, you know, government situations and unstable states around the world means we have to approach it with a different lens, and that's exactly what we're doing.
I guess I mean, though, when you say over here and over here and over here, where are those places? Because that hasn't been disclosed.
We've announced a few things. Helicopters are one, but you send helicopters, you're also sending 100, 150, 200 troops to support those helicopters, and those are technicians, those are maintenance people, those are command structures. There's, you know, it actually, in deploying the kind of equipment, whether it's a field hospital here or that, these are the things we need. And rather than us saying, this is what we're going to give to the UN, it's more of a negotiation with the UN. Well, what do you need? And what do we have that we can fill those things? And getting more countries to respond that way is actually going to allow peacekeeping operations to be much more effective in, you know, rapidly evolving situations around the world.
When you're thinking of Canada sort of stepping up into that vacuum, and you're weighing when you step up and where you step up, what goes through your head, I guess, and for a specific example on Jerusalem? Some leaders like Macron and Theresa May called Donald Trump and said, don't do it, this is a bad move. You didn't. Why not?
I think one of the things that we're very aware of, and Canadians are very aware of, is my responsibility is to have a constructive relationship with the United States and stand up very strongly and clearly for Canadian positions and values. I am going to, I've made it very clear that we're keeping the embassy in Tel Aviv, and we don't think that moving the embassy to Jerusalem is a good idea. But I don't think anyone would think that me making a big fuss about it is going to somehow change the president's mind on it. I have a good relationship with the president where he knows we disagree on a whole bunch of things, and so do I, obviously. But we still manage to work together on the things that we do agree on.
One of the big things I'm sure you guys have talked about is trade, obviously. I wanted to ask you if you think about the importance of a formal agreement, whether it be NAFTA or with China or with TPP, at least from the outside looking in. I'm not behind the scenes, but it seems like all three are hanging in the balance mm-hmm. right now. Is a formal agreement from your perspective the be-all end all?
Oh, yes. We want a predictable, clear framework so that businesses and workers, so Canadians can know what they're going to engage in and know how to play with the rules of the game so they can be sure that their investments and their building for the future will reach predictable ends. If you look at the rise of populism, the rise of nationalism around the world, there's this inward focus that ultimately is going to hurt economic growth, hurt economic trade, because people don't feel that trade is working for them. It's working for the big businesses, it's maybe working for political bottom lines, but it's not helping ordinary people. And that's why you get the populism and the nationalism. What we're saying instead is, what if we were able to sign trade deals that guaranteed that small businesses, that workers would have protections? Then we could move forward in the right direction. That's what we did with CETA. That's what we're doing in updating the Pacific Alliance. And those are the conversations we're having on the new TPP, on engaging with China, on the ASEAN, the Southeast Asia trade deal we're looking at, and of course, on the big one, on NAFTA as well. Saying, making sure that we put in provisions on environment, on labor, on women, is part of a way of making sure that they're good deals that people can support.
What if you can't get agreement on those exact provisions you're talking about? Has that become sort of the new red line?
I hate to talk about clear red lines, because the red line for us is the deal going to be good for Canadians or not? And good for Canadians, for me, means is it going to protect individuals' rights and workers' rights? Is it going to give us an opportunity to grow the economy in ways that include everyone, include the middle class, and those working hard to join it? That's the question I'm looking at. And if it doesn't, unlike what one of our former prime ministers said, I'm not going to sign any deal at any cost. If it's a bad deal, I'm going to walk away from it, because no deal is better than a bad deal for Canadians.
There's kind of an emerging narrative, especially around NAFTA, that the bottom of the Canadian economy won't fall out if there is no NAFTA, no formal NAFTA. What do you think of that argument?
I think NAFTA, a modernized NAFTA, is the best possible outcome, and that's certainly what we're working towards in a serious and diligent way. And we've successfully communicated to the administration that triggering a termination isn't going to have them be able to negotiate a better deal with Canada, because indeed we're seeing how it's not that we wouldn't suffer as a country, or we wouldn't take a hit if he canceled NAFTA. We would, but we also know that the U.S. would take a significant hit as well. It would hurt both of our sides, and making that argument very clearly sort of neutralizes that threat a little bit of, oh, I'm just going to rip it up. Well, okay, go ahead and do that. We'll figure out how to move forward. It won't be great, but we'll all survive. We'll dig in and figure it out, and we'll keep working for it in a constructive way. I think removing the drama from the dynamic has been something that we've been able to succeed at over the past years.
Okay, we'll leave it there. We're just gonna take a quick break, and we'll pick up the conversation right after that. Welcome back. What is, at this point in your time in office, the thing that keeps you up? Just one thing.
One thing, probably NAFTA, because there's a level of unpredictability, that it's out of our control. Mm-hmm. And you know, we know if the relationship with the U.S. goes sour, you know, we could be doing everything right at home and you know, our economy would still end up suffering. That's the level to which we are dependent on the U.S. So that's something that I think people know we've devoted an awful lot of energy to building a good relationship, but not just with the administration, which has been positive, but with governors, with different organizations, chambers of commerce, businesses. It's sort of been nice to be able to draw on all the amazing connections that Canadians themselves have made with folks in the United States over the course of our history, and draw on that at a time of stress to ensure that we're doing everything we can to make sure that everyone comes out of this okay.
And when you look forward, I'm guessing that the answer could be similar, but if you were to think about, you know, what is one thing that if I don't get done in this mandate, if I don't accomplish, I will really regret, what is that thing?
Well, I mean, obviously NAFTA is an example of that, but I think in general, when we took office, that we all recognized that the Canadian economy hadn't been doing as well as it should. We had periods of low growth. Yes, there was a recession, but at the same time, the frame that the previous government put on things of giving tax breaks and benefits to wealthier Canadians and hoping that it trickles down into more jobs for people wasn't one that we believed in. And we actually changed that around. And what we've seen over the past 2 years is it really has, and it has faster and more effectively than we even hoped it might.
So that sounded like a very political answer. So so basically you're focused on the economy over the next 2 years.
We're focused on the economy. That's what Canadians are focused on. How are they going to make sure that they have a good retirement? How are they going to make sure that their kids can go to schools and get good jobs? And then realizing the disruptions that are happening in our workplace, in the digital economy, whether it's AI or robotics or you know, quantum, can we make sure we're leading the way and we're engaging in it in a thoughtful way that's going to help the transition towards the new economy as it gets built? These kinds of things are what we're focused on.
Before we go, we are, of course, it is Christmas. And in the Christmas spirit, I thought I would ask you, as we head into this two-year election period, what is the best quality about your competition? Andrew Scheer, the leader of the Conservatives, and Jagmeet Singh, the leader of the NDP, each individually.
Andrew Scheer is most of the time a very pleasant fellow, and I've only met the leader of the NDP once or twice, so I don't really have much to say about Jagmeet other than he's a great example of the diversity of Canada that he came from a different background, and I think it shows that. That we're doing a lot of strides around making diversity a strength and not a weakness. It's a good thing.
Okay, we'll leave it there. Thanks for your time. Merry Christmas to you and your family, or as we say in Greek, Kala Christouyana.
Christos Anesti. That's Easter.
That's Easter.
And then Vanya Pola is just general.
Yeah, just in general. We
just
say
general
that a lot.
Yeah.
And then we say eat baklava.
Eat baklava. That's a good one.
Thanks for your time, Prime Minister.
Thank you,
appreciate it.
Merry Christmas.
You too.